So, my name is Emily Newman. I am the AHA Senior Education Coordinator, and I am happy to announce for our 9:30 program, we have Invisible No Longer, Politically Empowering the Humanist and Atheist Communities. We'll hear from Ron Millar, our political and PAC coordinator at the Center for Freethought Equality, as well as Sarah Levin, the founder of Secular Strategies, and newer director, Lily Balorian, who is our legal and policy director, and they'll be taking Q&A at the end.
So as Emily said, I'm Ron Millar. I'm the coordinator, political coordinator and PAC manager at the Center for Freethought Equality, which is, thank you, Maggie. We are the political and advocacy arm of the American Humanist Association. So we do the things that AHA is not allowed to do, like lobbying all the time or endorsing candidates, which is what I do with the Political Action Committee. So please, if you're not a member of the Center for Freethought Equality, and you can look on the back of your tag and see if you're eligible for the CFE annual meeting, please come to our table right across there and fill out one of these little forms. That way you can attend the 2:30 meeting that we have, where we can be as partisan as we want to be. And you also be a member of the Center for Freethought Equality, which is absolutely free, so there's no money now, but you know. We'll of course ask you for money, and we'll ask you for the candidates that we supporting. So for when you're doing your Q&A today, please keep it nonpartisan. The American Humanist Association cannot endorse or appear to endorse candidates, so we just wanna talk about general issues. When I come back up to the stage, our great panel here is gonna introduce themselves one at a time, and then I'll be back up here talking about sort of the history of what we have with elected officials, and then encouraging you and your groups to be more engaged in the electoral process. So, Sarah.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. My name is Sarah Levin. I'm founder and principal at Secular Strategies. We're a consulting firm specialized in advancing inclusive religious freedom policy and mobilizing the growing number of religiously unaffiliated Americans. I've been working with the Center for Freethought Equality and the Association of Secular Elected Officials, who are tabling outside. You should check them out. I think we have the president and founder in the audience, Leonard. Can I give you a shout out? There he is back there. You should get to know him. And you should check out their 1:30 meeting today, panel today. And we've been working with them to support our growing number of secular elected officials and empowering non-religious voters as a political constituency. I also serve as an open atheist on the Democratic National Committee's Interfaith Council. And today I'll be talking to you about the work that we're doing to build political clout for our community in two specific ways. So I first want to start with explaining what a caucus is, because I'm going to talk about two types of caucuses. Caucuses within legislatures and caucuses within political parties. So basically a caucus is like a formalized group of decision makers in the case of legislative caucuses, legislators, and in the case of political parties, members of the political party, around a shared mission that they work together to achieve within the legislative body or within that party. It could be a shared policy area like agriculture or gun control, and it can also be a shared identity like AAPI, an LGBTQ caucus, right? So hopefully all of you have heard by now that there is a Congressional Freethought Caucus that was founded in 2018, mostly due to Ron's work with Congressman Huffman, so round of applause for that, because that was historic, seriously. And Ron worked, that came after Congressman Jared Huffman came out as a non-theist. He's still the only openly non-theist member of Congress. He founded the caucus with Congressman Raskin, Kildee, and McNerney, and the caucus since 2018 has now grown to 16 members of Congress. So I'm gonna just quickly read to you the mission statement of the Freethought Caucus, which is to promote public policy formed on the basis of reason, science, and moral values, protect the secular character of our government by adhering to the strict constitutional principle of separation of church and state, to oppose discrimination against atheists, agnostics, humanists, seekers, religious and non-religious persons, and to champion the value of freedom of thought and conscience worldwide, and to provide a forum for members of Congress to discuss their moral frameworks, ethical values, and personal religious journeys. I want to note two things here. One, it's incredible. This is on, I'm reading from Congressman Huffman's website, right? And talking about our community specifically, calling out opposing discrimination against atheists, agnostics, and humanists. It's a really big deal. But it's also mentioning seekers and religious people, because it's really important that in this work, we remind people that separation of church and state and religious freedom protects religious freedom for everybody, people of all faiths and none. And most of the members of the Freethought Caucus are members of faith. And also that last part, providing a forum for members of Congress to discuss their moral frameworks, ethical values, and personal religious journeys. There are events that the caucus has with outside organizations like the AHA, like CFE, and Secular Coalition, and these other national organizations that lobby. But they also meet just together as colleagues, because members of Congress and legislators are human beings, right? They have, especially if they work in Congress, they have tough jobs. And so this is also a forum for them just to, in closed doors in a safe space, discuss these things with one another. So there is value in just building community with like-minded colleagues as well. So what kind of stuff does a caucus do? Why is it important that they exist? So here's a few examples of what the Freethought Caucus has done since it was founded in 2018. They've endorsed legislation like the No Ban Act, which would prevent anything like a Muslim ban from ever happening again, a bill that would strengthen protections against female genital mutilation, a bill that would increase scientific integrity. They've led letters, for example, opposing nominations of judges. They have led letters in partnership with other caucuses, like the Democratic Women's Caucus and the Equality Caucus, that addressed, went to 9 different federal agencies opposing new faith-based regulations under the Trump administration. They also, working with me and my client, Ex-Muslims of North America, a few years ago, sent a letter to Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg to ask questions and express concerns about censorship of atheists and particularly ex-Muslims on their platform. So I just gave you a lot of different examples of what a caucus can do, endorsing and, of course, also introducing legislation. Sending letters to private corporations to hold them accountable, sending letters to our federal agencies to hold them accountable, because remember that oversight is a key function of legislators, and also partnering with other legislators and caucuses around shared interests. In general, having caucuses in legislative bodies is an opportunity for organizations like the Center for Freethought Equality and others to work with them, because they have an established mission that aligns with our goals. And so we have a partner in that legislative body to advance our policy goals, as opposed to having to ad hoc find partners with this legislator, that legislator, find the co-sponsors, right, on ad hoc policy priorities we have. This is a group of legislators that have come together saying, this is what we want to do, we're aligned with these values, and we can work with them. So that started in Congress, right? But now we're starting to see caucuses at the state level as well. And pretty much in almost every state, you're going to find a prayer caucus. And you can probably guess the kind of work that they're doing, right? So they're working with Christian nationalist organizations that are shopping around their policy priorities. And so it's really important for us to have partners on the inside of legislative bodies to advance our priorities. Working with Representative Sherry Dutsey, who is a representative of New Hampshire and a board member of the Association of Secular Elected Officials, she started a Secular Values Caucus, which one of its first actions was to challenge the fact that their legislative meetings were starting with prayer every day, which were pretty much explicitly Christian. And while they were defeated, they had a very close vote where they almost changed the rules. And even the process of just having that conversation among her colleagues and bringing together other colleagues who are also upset, not all of them atheists, by the way, about these, you know, invocations, really is, that's the start of a really great opportunity for us to advance policy priorities in New Hampshire. We also have the Secular Government Caucus in Minnesota, which was established last year. Audrey is there in the audience. She can tell you all about that. We worked together on that. And the reason that that was possible is because activists like Minnesota Humanists, Minnesota Atheists, other folks for years have been building relationships with legislators in Minnesota who understand the importance of church-state separation. But they understand it and understand its urgency in great part because of the advocacy work of people on the ground who are meeting with them every year, year-round, talking to them about these issues and making clear that it's an important issue to our constituency. And so we're actually in conversation right now with the members of that caucus about legislation they can introduce in the next session, which is really, really exciting. So that's a little bit about caucuses in the legislature. I'm going to have to speed through a little bit the rest of this. So in every political party, you also have caucuses. And I work in the Democratic Party, so I'm just going to use those examples. But you can do this in whether you're a Republican, you're a Green, you're a Libertarian, or a Democrat, you can do this. In the Democratic Party, you'll pretty much find an LGBTQ or Stonewall caucus in almost every state party. You'll find a women's caucus, a black caucus. It's very similar. But the goals are a little bit different. So in 2016, when I was still at the Secular Coalition, I had two volunteers who worked in Texas, and they also were really involved in the Texas Democratic Party. And they said, hey, you know, we have our state convention coming up, and we would really love to have a secular presence. So we did two things. We got a secular caucus on the schedule, and I drafted planks, or also called resolutions, for consideration of the party platform, because that's one of the big things that parties do at their state conventions. They come up with their party platform. And long story short, the secular caucus was standing room only, hundreds of people, both non-religious people and people of faith, and we had three of the planks incorporated into the party platform that year, including one that called for the removal of the religious test for office that's still on the books on the Texas state constitution. Now, that was with very little marketing, and so what that taught me was that if you create a space for people to be both secular and Democrat and to address the church-state separation issues they're concerned about in a partisan space, they will come. My suggestion for you is whatever party you're associated with, is to just start going to the meetings, right? Find out where your local club is, get involved. A lot of times they're looking for people to run for positions, and that's a great way to get involved and start, you know, just learning the way that the party works. And then you start meeting people who are like-minded within the party, who have the same concerns as you are, and then you could start a caucus. And it doesn't have to be an official one. You can also kind of informally organize. And there's a few reasons to do this. One, influencing the platform, right? Two is to get to advocate for candidates within your party who are secular or aligned with our values, right? Because the parties aren't necessarily prioritizing increased representation of non-religious people in office. We need to fight for that. And that's what other caucuses do, right? A women's caucus is going to be supporting women running for office within the party. An LGBTQ caucus is going to be working to support their LGBTQ candidates. We need to show up for our secular candidates, which is another reason you should become a member of Center for Free Thought Equality, so you can learn about those candidates. But that's another way that you can help within the party structure. And lastly, it's to bring more secular people into your party. I can tell you that working with the Secular Caucus in Nebraska, they have told me, they have members who said, I did not join the Nebraska Democratic Party until I learned about the Secular Caucus because I didn't feel welcome as an atheist in this party. How am I doing on time, Emily? 1 minute. Okay, great. I'm going to talk a little bit with the last minute I have with how to get engaged with your electeds. You really want to be meeting with your elected officials at least once a year. You don't, a lot of times now, you can do it virtually since COVID, so it's a lot more accessible. You don't have to go to the state capitol. then you can just build a relationship throughout the year. And you can do that working with AHA. American Atheist has a great state advocacy program as well. Building those relationships and talking to them about these issues, informing them about the urgency of our issues is the beginning. That's how we start getting to a place where we are in Minnesota, where we can make an ask about introducing legislation or starting a caucus. But it really starts with relationships, because these ideas and this urgency has to come from constituents. It can't come from me and Ron at the national level. It has to come from you having consistent relationships with legislators and staff. So in terms of getting involved, work with your, build relationships with your elected officials, get involved with organizations that are doing that work. If you are involved in a party, start showing up. You will be amazed how far you can get in a political party just by showing up. So I'll stop there, and I'm happy to answer more questions. And now you hear from Lily.
Hello, good morning, everyone. My name is Lily Valorian. I am the legal and policy director for the American Humanist Association. Thank you. And I'm also the proud daughter of Iranian asylees. I've also been a long time, thank you, yes, go Iran. Freedom for Iran. So I am here, I'll be speaking today a little bit about the threat of white Christian nationalism and what actions we can continue to take to push back. So under the presidency of that last guy, we saw white supremacist Christian nationalism become emboldened in ways we've not seen in generations. 45 fanned the flames of the Christian nationalist right and set off a movement across the states to attempt to dismantle the indisputably secular foundation of our political system. Now, to be clear, the right has been meticulously organizing in the states for decades, but the last administration gave them the tools to plow through all of our norms to get whatever they want done. We know that the right has used Christianity to inflict violence upon marginalized people for decades. The best example, or one of the biggest ones, is the targeting and assassination of abortion providers. We know that since 1977, there have been 11 murders, 42 bombings, 196 arsons, 491 assaults, and since 2020, stalking of abortion providers has increased by 600%, and clinic invasions have increased by 129%. White Christian nationalism results directly into violence. We know and remember the disgusting attack on Charlottesville in 2017. That was a white Christian nationalist terrorist attack. And we know about the violent attempted coup on our Capitol on January 6th. These coordinated attacks are not happening in a vacuum. The attacks on trans folks we're seeing in the states are all examples of nationalist violence. We have a theocratic fascist in Ron DeSantis, right, in Florida. Do I have anyone from Florida here? Yes, love Florida, not a big fan of Ron. But I think it's critical for us to pay attention to Florida, because Ron DeSantis is using it as a laboratory for what they'd like the rest of America to look like. And so for me, I spoke earlier about how my parents are asylees from Iran. So watching white Christian nationalism take hold in this country is horrifying. My parents left a theocracy. They left the definition of what happens when religion and state marry. They left that to come here so I wouldn't have to deal with it, and here we are. Another fundamentalist religious group is taking over government. People often, we think about a dystopia. What would happen if they took full control of all of government? What could our country look like? But we don't need to use our imaginations. We can just look to the Islamic Republic of Iran and what they are doing to their people. Many of you may know, in September, a young woman, Mahsa Jina Amini, was murdered by morality police in Iran. The reason for this was that she was allegedly not wearing her headscarf properly. They have a morality police for that. Hundreds of young people have been killed for fighting against this. Thousands, 12,000 to be exact, political prisoners are in Iran at the moment. And at least four, and trigger warning, at least four of these prisoners were executed by the government. One of these individuals, Majid Reza Rahnavard, in the last moments, his executioners asked him to take on Islam, to repent, and he said, "I refuse. I refuse." He looked his executioners in the eye, and he said that, "I do not want anyone to read any religious books for me. I want you to celebrate, and I want you to fight for freedom." Now, I talk about Iran, and it sounds like an extreme example, but I'm telling you right now, that nation, in less than a year, went from a secular government to a theocratic fascist regime, and it's been here for 44 years. And if you think it can't happen here, I have a bridge to sell you. But let me say this. Despite how loud Christian nationalists are, we know that individuals in the United States tend to be way less religious now than ever before. According to Pew, in 2021, about 3 in 10 adults now affiliate with being non-religious. 63% of the population identifies as Christian. In 2007, 78% of the nation identified as Christian. This presents a huge opportunity for progressive humanism to step into that gap. However, let's be real. Our numbers have to continue to grow to rise to the threat. And when we're thinking about growing our numbers, we need to ensure we're centering bringing new folks into the fold. You know, when you look at the demographics of folks who are in this movement, we're not seeing nearly enough young folks at all. We need to have a much more inclusive movement if we want to win. And I want to win, and I think you all want to win, and I think you all know we have to win. So, while white Christian nationalists across the country are acting quickly to legislate their insidious agendas, they don't sleep, remember that. We see right now, for example, that Texas has put up a bill mandating that every public classroom receiving public dollars has to prominently place the Ten Commandments on the wall of their classrooms. This is where we're at. But we need to understand that just because something like that is happening in Texas does not mean that those of us who live comfortably in blue and purple states don't have an obligation to stand up and fight for our neighbors there. We have to be everywhere. So school boards right now are becoming kind of ground zero for some of the most insidious attacks. They are banning books, they are changing the curriculum, they're rewriting history, they are lying and gaslighting people about the ideals that this nation purports to be about. They are lying. And so it can be intimidating. And if you live in a red state, it can be really scary. But if even one person shows up to a school board meeting when they're about to pass disgusting, disgusting policies that will harm trans people, for example, even one person standing up causes a ripple. I know it's scary, but be there. Every time they do something, we have to show them we are not afraid. We'll meet them there. They will always have resistance. And when they know that, they'll have to rein it back in. But I don't think we've shown them exactly our strength yet. And so I'll close just by saying this, that in order for us to win, and I do believe that we will win, we need to continue to work together to create cohesiveness in our movement and expand to the greater progressive movement. Make sure we're on the same page because we have a huge threat and we need all of our numbers to do it, to fight it back. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lily, and welcome to the team. We're thrilled to have you. So I want to just go over a little bit about how we've become a little more visible, but we're not visible enough yet. I can see people over the glaring lights a little bit, so I have a little test question. Who is the first member of Congress to ever identify with the atheist and humanist community? Raise your hands, anybody know? Call it out if you know.
Pete Stark.
Pete Stark, excellent, yay. That happened way back in 2007. I was working at the Secular Coalition for America. David Nyosi said, why don't we have a competition to see what's the highest elected official we find? And you know, back then, dog catcher, we might have a couple. So we got recommendations. Lori Lipman Brown, who was the director, went out and talked to folks, and we had a meeting with Stark's office, and he said, yes, I'm a Unitarian who does not hold a belief in a supreme being. And we were like, yay, floored. We didn't expect it, you know. And so he agreed to be public about that. And then he started getting invited to meetings with the AHA and other groups. And then he said, well, maybe I'm a humanist now. And then he took on the term atheist. So as soon as he found community, he embraced our more common terms for ourselves. So that's important when you're meeting with elected officials, because once they know that there's a constituency, they'll feel more free to be their authentic selves. So then we actually had a false start. When Joe Biden was elected vice president, he appointed one of his longstanding colleagues to fill the seat until the next election. And the person wrote about how he had a humanist and a Catholic parent. And we're like, we could have a senator. So Lori went to meet them. Just accidentally, it was meeting on Ash Wednesday, and walked into the office and saw the little ashes, and it's like, well, we know he went with the Catholic side. So we still haven't had a senator yet. We hope to have that happen. But in 2017, Pete Stark responded to one of the candidate questionnaires that I send out to members of Congress and candidates. I do it at the federal and state level, and occasionally some local races. And he sent it back. It had, and this is in 2017, it had a sort of nebulous idea about, you know, how I identified with religion. We did a bunch of emails back and forth. And then finally we were able to set up a meeting. Roy and I went and had lunch with him, talked about the pros and cons of announcing his membership of our community. He set up meetings with his colleagues, with his key contributors and constituents. Even talked to the chaplain of the Congress for some reason. I don't know why he wanted to talk to that person, but he did. And obviously talking to his family members. And he decided it was safe enough for him to make the announcement. And he did. And we got a little fanfare from that. And as we were having dinner with him that night, we laid out several things that we would love for him to do. And one of them was, you know, we would love to have a caucus, as Sarah was talking about, but you know, it's hard to have a caucus of one. But after he made the announcement, several of his colleagues came up and said, you know, how proud they were of him for making this, you know, announcement, and wanted to be there to protect him in case any flashback came on it. And so then he started the Congressional Freethought Caucus. And again, Roy and I, Roy Speckhart, who was the former executive director, and I were invited to Huffman's house, townhouse that he has on Capitol Hill. And the first person to show up when we were doing this was Jamie Raskin. And Jamie came in and like, oh, great, a caucus of two. But then as more and more people came in, he got really excited. It was just great to see his emotional span over that meeting, because he's like, this could really be something. And of course, now he co-chairs the caucus with Jared. So again, it's knowing that others are in the fight with you. And so that's why we really need to be more visible and meeting with elected officials, meeting with candidates. So I'm sure you're all very politically active, but as Lily's talking about, we are in the fight of our lives. This white Christian nationalism is very dangerous, as we've seen from January 6th and other events across the country. We have now grown as a population that we can counter that if we get organized and we get visible and we get active. And we're not doing it just to fight against Christian nationalism. We're doing it because we want to see our values in public policy. And the only way we can do that is through the electoral arena. Because there was one time that there was this thing called the Supreme Court that would occasionally stand up and support underrepresented groups and provide some basic protections. Well, that's gone. We can't count on the courts to even give us the basic protection. So we've got to fight in the electoral arena. That's the only opportunity we have to protect ourselves. And so I know that, you know, most atheists and humanists are very active in the electoral arena, but we have to redouble our efforts. So on our website at the Center for Free Thought Equality, we have an entire page about what individuals can do to be more involved in the electoral arena. Obviously, you got to vote. And not just during presidential elections, you got to vote in every election. Yeah, because local elected officials have more of an impact on your day-to-day life than the president or any federal. And you have to be an informed voter. So we also have links to things like Vote 411, which is the League of Women Voters site. There's Ballotpedia, which gives information. There's Project Vote Smart. So use those resources. The other best resource to use is find out, you know, where the religious right groups, they always put out voter guides. Just see who they're endorsing and, you know, vote the opposite way. Because they do the work for you. So it's not only voting, though. Voting is like the bare minimum. When you're making your budget for the year, make a budget for how much money you're going to donate to candidates, how much time you're going to spend working for candidates or your preferred political party. And budget that in, because it's not just going to happen. You have to make a plan for it, and you have to make sure it works within what you can do. Obviously, you know, there might be limitations on your time, there might be limitations on the money you can give, but work out a balance that you can deal with that. Volunteering is so huge. You know, find the candidates that you like. If you're in a safe blue state and everything is perfect in your area, you have the greatest bubble you've ever lived in, reach out to neighbors, because, you know, there's phone banking, texting, which I abhor, but texting is huge, and you can text for candidates all across the country. So adopt a poor, horrible place that you can make a difference. Attend political events and wear your humanist and atheist swag so that you're visible. Get a group of your friends together so it's not just you.
Buy a hoodie.
Buy a hoodie. Exactly. It's all kind of swag out there. But again, it's making our community visible in the political arena. Get active, like I said, in your party politics. And most importantly, think about running for public office. I know it's intimidating. Probably not a lot of people here will be running for president. Congress is also intimidating. But state legislatures are out there. There's over 7,000 seats in state legislatures. But there's also 500,000 local elected officials throughout the country. There's going to be a position that's just ideal for you and your background. So think about that. There's also all those commissions and other things that impact your community. So feel free, you know, join up with those, work with that to make your community better, and do it again as a visible humanist and atheist, because, you know, in addition to getting our values into public policy, the more visible we are, we're going to eliminate that bias that still exists against our community. And that only happens, well, it happens if we get elected officials who people respect. That helps, but it also helps when you're introducing yourself to community members and people in the electoral arena and openly identifying as an atheist and humanist. But, so that's individuals. Your groups can also be, Your groups can also be very active. Your groups can do that basic civics that nonprofits are allowed to do. Make sure your members are registered to vote. You can have a little web page about links to voting registration, what elections are coming up, but just make sure they're aware of the electoral process in your community. Invite elected officials to speak to your group or go visit them as a group. We have a website where we have the 73 elected officials at the state level who identify with us. And that's up from 5 from 2016. But we have a ways to go, because if we want to reach parity with our population, we need another 1,500. So we've got a lot of work to do. But get to know those 73 people. They need to know that you're out there as a constituency and your groups can go visit them, or visit your elected officials regardless if they're on my list or not, because again, you want them to know that we are a constituency out there. You can send letters to candidates. You can do voter guides. You can have candidate forums, but you gotta be careful about how you do that. And fortunately, there's this great advocacy arm of the Alliance for Justice. It's called Boulder Advocacy, and it spells out exactly what you can do as a C3 nonprofit and what you can't do. And it's absolutely free, and it's Boulder, not like the city up here, but B-O-L-D-E-R. And again, you can find it on our website, because we have information on what groups can do, and then we link off to Boulder Advocacy. So thank you very much. Please, again, keep the questions nonpartisan, and come to our 2:30 show across the way. Become a member of the Center for Free Thought Equality. It's completely free. And go see Leonard and the board at 1:30 for the Association of Secular Elected Officials. Thank you very much.
In case you don't already know, the website that Ron kept recommending you check out is cfequality.org. We'll be taking questions both virtually and in person. Go for it.
Thank you so much for the excellent presentations. I've been very impressed. The question I have is, given the meritocracy currently existing in America, and the concentration of wealth, particularly in the religious community, how do you plan on countering that? And if you would also put in the context of the National Prayer Breakfast and the type of funding and money that's made available to political candidates based on religious affiliation.
Thank you very much. We're not going to compete with money. Leonard Leo, who orchestrated the takeover of the Supreme Court, just recently got a $1.6 billion contribution. So we don't have that. But fortunately, voting is one vote at a time, so you don't get the $1.6 billion. We're not going to change the political system right away that we're in. Big money does affect it horribly. But we got to do what we can do. As individuals, as groups, to counter that by organizing ourselves, getting out there, getting people registered and voting. We're not going to meet them with money, but hopefully we can meet them with the same intensity and numbers.
I would just add that obviously money makes a huge difference in campaigns, but the candidates that spend the most don't always win. You guys remember when Tom Steyer ran for president? But you still want to be able to, I think it's really important to donate to campaigns, even if they're not going to outspend their rivals. They do need to hit a baseline to be relevant, to get the name recognition. So just because we can't outspend them doesn't mean that we shouldn't be giving. So I just want to make that clear, because the candidates need money. They don't necessarily need the most money, but they do need enough to compete.
Hello, is this on? Yes. So obviously there are a lot of groups out there, but two that I don't think I heard mentioned, and I wonder what your connections with them are Bill McKibben and Codger Power and Emily's List. Any comments?
I didn't hear the first one, sorry.
Bill McKibben is one of our eco-environmental activists, and he created a group called Codger Power. As in old codgers?
Right, right. No, I know he's focusing on seniors, so that's, yeah, it's excellent work. No, there are lots and lots of groups out there, and, you know, if one touches your passions, you know, get involved. But, you know, there's Run for Something, there's the Progressive Campaign Committee. Yeah, so if again, it's getting involved, it's following your passion, it's creating a passion for being involved in the electoral arena.
Okay, I actually have two pitches to make. One of which is, as one of your secular elected officials, I'm going to say, run for office. Everybody here, run for office. It's not that hard. Start small. I'm not important. Keep this in mind. I'm a library trustee, okay? But the point is, I can be a library trustee, so can you. You can run for a school board. There are all kinds of elected commissions. And if you know the people in your area and you get involved in politics at all, there are always openings, and if you are generally considered sane and a good citizen and you have sort of some ability to work in whatever the arena of that elected office is, you can go for it, and you may well be elected, and it may wind up being a rewarding position. And it does mean that when there's something that comes up that is actually having to do with secular values, among other things, you not only have a voice, but you know who to call. So I've known the lawyers to call on the very rare occasions when this has come up, but it's also just a good way of enacting these values just with really every vote that we take. So that's my first pitch. My second pitch is for sample legislation. I am the proud co-author of Massachusetts Bill H.471, which basically ensures that peer-reviewed, empirically-based science is taught in Massachusetts public schools. Now, this is not a lift in Massachusetts. We still don't have it passed, but the point is, if you're in a friendly state, put in legislation like this, this is what the right does all the time. They put sample legislation. Anti-science is usually a place they start. To basically see if they can get something passed somewhere. And then once it's in one state, it broadens to other states and then often broadens to the national stage. So we can do that too. So as I said, I'd like to see the equivalent of H.471 in every state legislature, and it's not that hard to do. So as I said, please sample legislation, do it in your state, and support it and see where it can go. And yeah, it's a long process, but it's not that hard. Thank you. Oh, and by the way, thank you very much for all the work you're doing.
Yeah, thank you very much for your public service. Again, there's 500,000 elected official, local elected officials out there. And like she was saying, if there's a vacuum, guess who's gonna fill that? The White Christian Nationalists. So we can't allow anyone to be unopposed. You know, so look for those races, make sure they don't just walk into office.
I want to say something about model legislation. First of all, there is starting to be more work done in that space. So there are actually model bills that if you're engaging with elected officials that you can propose. But I also want to note that just because if you live in a blue state, there is not a single state in the U.S. that has a perfect record on church-state separation. And you might be surprised the kind of religious exemptions or, you know, you'll be surprised what might be on the books in your state. I always love to go to the American Atheist website for this because they have a scorecard of every state and shows you where they have negative provisions in place and where they have positive provisions in place and where they have a lack of positive provisions in place where things could be improved. So, for example, I just finished up helping to run the California Advocacy Day. And we were lobbying for two bills, one of which would One makes California even more of a safe haven for abortion by making sure that if anyone is coming to our state for an abortion or gender-affirming care, and they're being prosecuted by their home state, that California law enforcement is not allowed to cooperate with the law enforcement in that other state. We also lobbied for a bill that would eliminate a barrier for low-income folks to get funding to buy menstrual products, which are already expensive and are getting more expensive. Now, think about that. California is a liberal state. It's not like there was a policy intentionally trying to prevent people to get that funding through that program for menstrual products. But there's so many little niches in policy where there's just, you know, wasn't thought put into it, right? So there's always room for improvement. So just remember, if you're in a blue state, like, don't be complacent. Don't assume that there's no work to do. And if you have the privilege of having allies in your legislature, ask them to be champions and bring them ideas to even further improve your state's record on church-state separation. Yes.
I have a question for Sarah and one for Ron. For Sarah, the question I have is, a lot of your organization, Free Thought Caucus, is about ensuring that the Establishment Clause prevails over on religious issues. But there are people who claim that they're not actually preferring that their religion is being weaponized or prioritized when they oppose abortion or oppose LGBT rights or oppose a physician aid in dying. And yet it's pretty clear that many of the people who oppose abortions are basing it on religious beliefs. And most people believe that when they oppose abortion, it really is a mechanism for imposing their particular religious beliefs on others. But it doesn't, they try to hide behind the fact that it's not really a reflection of their beliefs, even though about 85% of the people who oppose abortions are people of faith and belong to a particular religion. I'm just curious how you deal with that, because there are some atheists that are that oppose abortion, although it's a very small minority. And then on the end of life issue, much of the impetus for that comes from the idea that when Christ died, that he didn't accept some salve, and that therefore that suffering is redemptive and that we should celebrate that. And so, again, it comes out of a religious belief, but it's a way of trying to circumvent claiming that they're imposing their religion.
Mm-hmm. So I think this is where messaging and education really comes into play, because I think we have to constantly be calling out exactly what you're calling out, because they are trying to hide it. In fact, I noticed that in, for example, medical aid in dying and working with Compassion and Choices, I remember talking to their staff about, they were sharing with me how the evolution of how they kind of were more upfront about their religious objections when they first started out, but the Christian right really started hiding that more and using different argumentation and you know, employing, you know, wedge tactics with the disability community, all these types of things, because they know they don't want to be called out for that. But it is really obvious. It's a very obvious connection,
right,
for us. But those connections that you're talking about are not necessarily obvious for even our allies in legislatures, right? Like, people don't talk about these issues in terms of religious freedom and church-state separation, which is why I think it's really important, even on issues that other organizations are leading on, like abortion and medical aid in dying, we have a really unique perspective on these issues and the ability to tie it back to the Establishment Clause. And so I think bringing up these issues and framing them in terms of religious freedom, calling out, because sometimes all you have to do is see, you know, the Catholic lobby on a medical aid in dying bill, you can show them how much they're spending to oppose the bill, right? So that there's really obvious ways that you can point that out. I would also say, just on the abortion issue, the amount of people who are non-religious who oppose abortion is a really, really small amount. But I think even people like that, you know, there's religious beliefs, but there's also conscience, right? Sincerely held beliefs don't always have to be faith-based. And if you are an atheist who has a sincerely held belief, not for a religious reason, that abortion is wrong, that's fine. But you still can't, for the same reason that a religious person can, impose that belief on me. Because I also have a sincerely held belief about that issue that is equally of value, right? So it's not like we are, you know, cornered on that issue. We still have a pretty good argument to stand on for that.
Thank you to all. We actually need to take Isabella, who is representing our virtual people who do not have a chance to talk to our folks in person later. But again, 2:30, you can bother them more during the CFE meeting. Isabella.
Hello. So the first question is, a lot of your recommendations were focused on finding and supporting your political allies, but is it worth it to work with those who are not politically aligned, and if so, in what ways? And that is the first of two questions.
Yeah, I'm not sure about not being politically aligned. Obviously, we want to work with members who identify with us, and but also who are our allies on the issues. And it is surprising sometimes you'll find someone who you disagree with on 90% of the stuff, but then you'll find that elected official who, you know, is really great about, you know, in like in Pennsylvania, there are folks who are working with one of our identified members to get people to be able to go after the Catholic Church on abuse issues. And so you can find little pieces that you can work with people that you wouldn't normally work with. So you can find common ground occasionally.
Yeah, I would just say that in general, I think that we need to meet people where they're at, and I think that we shouldn't be afraid to talk to folks who don't align with us. I think we need to talk to them. And I think that it comes back a lot of it to messaging, and I think that when I speak to folks on the right, they really, the concept of government mandate is like where they're like, I'm not into that. And so I think that there is some potential fertile ground that we might be able to build some bridges with folks who we never thought we would. And I think it's worth trying, because we need to always grow our numbers, and we shouldn't be so siloed just with our allies.
Unfortunately, I'm getting the cutoff sign from others. So for the other virtual ones, we'll see if there's a way that we can maybe put that into discussion forum and follow up. You can also always email our panelists. And so thank you all. Again, friendly reminder that as concise as we can make our questions, that would help us get to everything. So the next session, 10:30, multi-faith engagement is in Big Thompson, and climate change education is in Platte River.
Where are
they? They are to the left, go down the hall. There will be people directing.